There's barely such a thing as a typical day in the America's Cup, but a race day comes closest to routine for Cup teams. By the time a Cup boat and crew have completed two races, the chances are that the team as a whole has been operational for 10 to 11 hours. And while you might expect the AC75 to be towed home, hosed off and locked up for the night, the third phase of their daily routine is just about to get underway. It's not uncommon for teams to roll into a practice session after racing before heading back to base. Time in any Cup campaign is precious, and once you're into the event, the clock is counting down for real. Any lost hours are just that. But even if teams wanted to spend more time out testing and training, there's a detailed management and maintenance schedule waiting for them on shore that extends well into the night and beyond. Okay, so the guys go out, they then race, they do one or two races, whatever it is. Racing finishes for the day. Boat comes back in. Talk us through then the operation, how long that takes from the point at which it comes around the end of that harbour and we see it come in.
Yeah.
What happens after that?
Yeah, the team sort of splits up at that stage, the sailing team and the sort of engineering team go and focus on performance, race analysis. And I break up into groups to sort of look at how the boat performed and how the crew sailed. And then there's a shore team that'll pull the boat out of the water and basically give it a good wash, get all the salt water out of it. A big drying session, so making sure the boat's dry, thoroughly dried out with all the electronic systems on board. It's pretty critical that we give that good attention. And then we just go through it with a fine tooth comb. We have an NDT person on site who can go through and scan all of the composite structures and the critical composite structures on board, whether it's foil arms or chain plates or camp bulkheads. And we have areas that we know we need to give close attention to. So that happens. The foil prep team, even just going for a sailing session, the amount of damage you can have on the paint finish of your foils is interesting, whether it's through cavitation or hitting things in the water. So they'll begin their process of minor touch-ups and repairs. And then, it's just about getting it ready for the next day. In these rounds that we have now, there's not a lot of downtime to service the yacht, so we're constantly sort of making sure we have track of the hours on all of our systems, whether it's hydraulic systems or pumps or actuators, and we sort of, as they come through their lifing process, they might trigger a cylinder needs to be rebuilt or a pump needs to be rebuilt, and then we'll make the decision then whether it's worth opening up the system and servicing that pump or pushing it to later in the round, depending on data, basically. So it's a thorough couple of hours of understanding how the boat performed, do we have any issues going into the next day, and what needs to be sort of on the job list that night.
How long will just the wash down and dry down, sorting all out, how long does that take, an hour, 2 hours?
Yeah, I'd say from the time we connect the hook onto to the yacht and crane the boat out, it's about half an hour to get it into its cradle, give it a good wash, and then it should be back in the shed within an hour, I'd say. And then a drying team will come on of about six or seven people, and they spend about 20 minutes just sort of making sure it's all mopped out. We have dehumidifiers drop down from the roof, and they sort of blow all night long and try and keep the boat dry. And at that stage, technicians will come down and make sure that there's no hydraulic leaks. We'll get feedback from the sailing team about whether some of the electronics were playing up during the day or not, and areas that we need to focus on. Otherwise, it's pretty systematic checking.
And so from there, presumably then there's a maintenance program that happens from there on in. So roughly what time, I'm just trying to think what time that would be, but by the time you sort of, typically you're getting in at what, 5, 4, 5, something like that?
Yeah, 5, 5:30.
So then it's going to be in the shed at 6.
Yeah, we're in the shed by about 6:30,
right,
which is when most of the team have dinner at that
right.
time. And the night shift are up and running. And there'll be a bit of a handover period for a couple of hours. So sort of all hands on deck, get it to that state where we understand what the workload is for that night. If it's basic maintenance stuff, the night shift will pick up most of those tasks. But if we have a situation where we've broken something or we need to service something more thoroughly, then the day shift will stay on a bit longer just to try and hit it with people. But I'd say the day shift are trying to look for the door at about 8 o'clock at night, 8:39. But there'll be engineers trawling through data as well at that stage, just to make sure that the systems were behaving as they should. You know, sometimes the sailing team won't really be the first to see a problem. It'll come through in data, whether there is a system deteriorating or something like that. And that takes time to get through that data. And then there'll be a 9 o'clock, someone come running out saying, we need to go and look at this pump or that actuator, or the flap wasn't responding today, why not? So that comes through quite late at night.
And then, so the night shift, so how long will they then work for, and what are they doing?
That sort of varies again on the workload for that day. You know, if we can get them out of here in the early hours, sort of 12, 1 or 2 in the morning. You know, but like I say, there was a maintenance day yesterday, so we took on a bit more in terms of our wing prep. We had some damage from the previous day, so we've repaired that, which meant that they were here late last night, just doing the final sort of finishing touches before the scanning happened. So it's variable, and I think that's one of the tough things in these Cup teams is, from one night to the next, or from one day to the next, you've got to be ready for anything.
Mm. And how, I mean, these have always been sophisticated, complex boats, but I get the impression that they've just been getting more and more complex as the cycle's been going on. Does it feel like that, or are you dealing with now what you expected to be dealing with 2 years ago when you started?
Yeah, I mean, it certainly steps up every iteration. I think we all thought the boats in Auckland were quite complicated. And now that the systems, the ability to open up the systems and link them to each other and have more software involved and more electronics involved and more sensors involved, I think, you know, the level of complexity does increase. And as the designs have got closer and closer, I think attention to detail has to grow, to make sure that you're getting everything out of your boat. So I think last time we were all sort of learning so much about these boats, it was hard to know which area to look at, spend more time looking at. But whether it's sails or appendages or systems, it's about getting everything out of the boat, and it needs to be performing at 100%. So you look closer at every little detail now, I think.
And finally, the Mercedes element has been a large part, obviously, of this whole campaign. How much does Brackley play a part in the daily sort of routine of what happens down here?
Yeah, I'm sure they'd all rather be here, but I think sometimes it's quite good having a group of people who are looking really basically at data. So we have 6 or 8 engineers watching the racing, watching the boat sort of, the data coming off the yacht, listening to the team on board. But that's about as close as they get to the yacht, so they've really got to make some decisions based on data. A lot of them are focused on performance, so they're feeding analysis through to how we're tacking from day to day, how our jibes were, and tracking that over time and where we can find improvements on that. But yeah, there's a big group up there that's connected to us in a supporting role, and you know, trying to make sure that we're keeping an eye on our servicing timelines and bits and pieces like that. So. But I think it's easy to be distracted by the noise here and the obvious thing that's in front of us. Having a group that can sort of sit down and just look at the numbers and you know, provide feedback based on that is very useful.
A sustainable future. Yamar.